Hey, what's going on, everyone? Welcome to a new video. So, judging by what you're looking at on screen right now, is an Xbox One related video. Just like I did back in April, this is to do with the new Xbox update that's come out, the Xbox One Fall update for 2017. So it seems like every update for the last while has been some sort of major update, and this is no exception. They're changing the dashboard again. There is a bit of a reason behind it. Microsoft is introducing a new design language across all their products right now, and so Xbox is no exception to this, but from someone who isn't paying attention to this stuff like I am, it just seems like, you know, they're changing the dashboard for no apparent reason. It's not changing too much, but there is, you know, some changes to it, and honestly, I think it looks a bit nicer. One of the new features is going to be the new Fluent Design Language, which is coming to Windows 10, Xbox, whatever else, you know, they have going on is going to be based on with this new design language. There's going to be support for Xbox One X stuff, like the ability to transfer games, the ability to download all the 4K assets that are required for Xbox One X games or Xbox One X enhanced games. You can download them right now because Xbox One X isn't released yet as of the filming of this video. So you can download all the 4K assets and stuff now and then transfer them later. That's been added with this update, as well as a bunch of new other features. So, you know, without further ado, let's get started. This is going to be an installation and just a general tour of the update. So, you know, just to, you know, for you guys who are interested in this sort of experience. So as always, you need to have the latest update to be signed into Xbox Live, and I've actually left this for a few days. One thing they've actually allowed you to do over the last while, I think, I don't remember when they started doing this, but you've been able to, you know, postpone, but not update the console to right away, and I think this update's been sitting here for a few days, but now it's forcing me to do it. I haven't played my Xbox in a couple of days, so. Yeah, so, let's start the update. It's going to be about 700 and something megs in size, I can't read from here. So yeah, so let's start the update. You can skip and stay offline or turn off the console, but that's no fun. Let's start doing the update. So, like any update, it's going to be doing it in three stages. So, be back at the end of whatever stage, you know, is interesting. So, like any update, it's going to be doing it in three stages. So, we're on the first one now, and this is going to be, you know, it downloading the update, then it's going to be verifying the update, and then applying it. So, yeah, like previous ones, this installation screen will be a little different depending on your console. So I have an original Xbox One, so that's why I have the image of the original Xbox One. If you're installing this on a One S, then you'll have a picture of a One S there. Yeah, so I'll be back once we're done this. So the system just rebooted here, and as you can see, some of the new design language is already coming through. It looks similar. The Fluent Design Language looks similar to what the, you know, the old, you know, Microsoft Design Language 2 looked like, or MDL2 looked like, but, you know, you can see the screen is a little different now, and this actually should, be different depending on what console you have. Because I have an original Xbox One, and my original Xbox One is black, I have the dark theme enabled by default. I think if you have an Xbox One S, which by default comes in white, you have the light theme enabled by default, and that is a new thing. There is a new system-wide light theme that we'll take a look at once it's done installing here. And, like I said, the picture of the console there on the screen will change depending on what console you have. If you have an Xbox One X, which will come with the fall update pre-installed, any future updates will, you know, have this installation screen, and you'll have a One X there as well. Fast, fun, all for you. Make the home yours with everything you care about. dive right into games and broadcasts and do more faster in the guide. As you can see, this is, you know, we can see some fluent design elements here, and I bumped the camera by accident, I apologize. You can see the glow around the buttons there, and we'll get more into the design in a minute, but... so we can watch a video on what's new, so maybe this might make my video redundant, but alright, let's watch the video anyway, see what it is.
What's new in the fall update? The fall update helps you get to fun faster. When you land on home, get right back to what you were doing. Just press A. One step down are your games and apps. The ones you've used recently are right here, ready to go again. Below that, customize home for how you play. Your pins are here, and you can add your favorite games and people directly to home so you can find them at a glance. Add games from any game tile or game hub, and friends from their profile. You'll find more personalization options and settings, including your choice of dark or light theme. The guide has been refreshed to get you around faster, too. One press of the Xbox button opens it, and a press of the A button gets you back to home, your games and apps, the store, or your pins. Move left and right with the left stick, D-pad, or bumpers without having to move in and out of vertical tabs. Active parties and broadcasts now show up on the main tab so you can keep up with what's happening. USB webcams can now be used with your Xbox One. With an off-the-shelf USB webcam, you can broadcast yourself alongside your gameplay in Mixer or video chat with friends on Skype. Record longer game clips by using an external storage drive. Game clips captured directly to a USB drive can be up to 60 minutes long and can easily be transferred to a PC for advanced editing. Your clips can be 1080p on all Xbox One consoles and 4K on Xbox One X. Find answers and tips in Xbox Assist.
So there we go, overly happy sounding bitch aside, this is the new Xbox One dashboard. So you can see, navigation is very similar, basically the same as what it was before. You still have the five tabs above on the top row, and you can still navigate going up and down with, you can still use the triggers as well to go up and down. So one press of the trigger goes all the way to the bottom. Right trigger and left trigger goes all the way to the top. It's a little slow, it seems like. I don't know, maybe it might get faster now that it's, you know, booted. Clicking left doesn't go open the guide anymore. Okay. But if you press the home button, or the Xbox button, you get to the guide. So, this is, using a new fluent design language. So you can see, you know, fluent design is very, it's similar to... What Microsoft had before, which was called Microsoft Design Language 2 or MDL2, which was an evolution of the Metro design language that they were using in Windows 8 and 8.1 and Windows Phone and all that stuff. MDL2 came about with Windows 10 and it sort of toned a lot of that down. Fluent design is a big it's a big welcome in my book because it adds some much-needed design flair to Microsoft products, not just Xbox, but to Windows 10 as well. In the Fall Creators Update, you know, that's also out as well as the same time as this, Windows Fluent Design Language is now, you know, part of a lot of Windows 10, and it will be coming to... It's not complete in Windows 10 yet, but it will be over time, so... So the Mixer tab is the same, Community tab looks... the Community tab is different. Entertainment tab looks the same, and the store tab looks the same. I wish the background that you were using for your Xbox went over to the store tab. As you can see, the store tab has a grey background there. But when I go over, you can see the BMW in the background there. So enough rambling. Let me go ahead and demonstrate some of the features, some of the ones that were talked about in the video that we just watched, as well as some other features that weren't mentioned.
So I'll switch over to capture here. So instead of just pointing the camera at the screen DSP style, we can actually see it more clearly. So.
Oh!
The Xbox One Fall Update for 2017. Here is the new dashboard, and as you can see, it looks very similar to the old dashboard, but also different at the same time. Its navigation is the same, so you still have the five tabs across the top here. So, store, entertainment, community, mixer, and home. But there are some differences. So you can still navigate using the bumpers to go left and right, as well as the triggers to go up and down. So you can see my pins and there's a welcome section as well, so there we go. If you press the right bumper, you go all the way to the bottom, in theory. There we go. And if we go press the left bumper, we go back to the top there. So one thing I noticed it doesn't do is pressing left on the home screen on the D-pad doesn't open the guide anymore. The guide is just a single press of the Xbox button, which is the way it was in the old version, but now as you can see, instead of having vertical tabs, we now have horizontal tabs, so we can navigate those using any variety of ways. You can use the D-pad, or you can use the thumbstick, or you can use the bumpers, which is what I prefer. So there we go. So we have achievements, multiplayer, so we can, achievements, I can see the achievement list, the gamer score leaderboard, recent achievements, and I can go and view my achievements. This would change in game, I guess. So if I had, say, Grand Theft Auto open, I could view the achievements for Grand Theft Auto. Multiplayer, I can start a party, invitations, I can look for a group, and tournaments. People, so I can go and view my friends list. I've got two friends online at the moment, so I can one friend is in a game apparently. So clubs and recent players as well. So recent players, it pops up a separate submenu here as well, and I can view recent players as well that I have been playing with. So, and of course, hitting the bumpers still goes up and down as well. So navigation is the same as it was before, which is nice because I really liked the old layout, and I think this honestly brings a lot of design flair to it. Fluent design brings a lot of design flair to the Microsoft design language. It is an evolution of the artist formerly known as Metro, which was introduced back in the Windows Phone 7 and Windows 8 days, as well as when the Xbox One first came out, it was Metro all the way. But then around the time of Windows 10's release in 2015, Microsoft evolved Metro into what was called Microsoft Design Language 2, or MDL2. That basically was like Metro, but toned way the fuck down. Fluent design is sort of like Metro 3.0, I guess, is what you would call it, because it's very similar to the Microsoft Design Language. It keeps its sort of minimalism that Metro had, and as well as, live tiles and stuff, but it brings, some different elements to it. As you can see, the selection here is glowing a bit, as well as, so there's five distinct fluid design traits, I guess we would call it. One's called material, light, scale, depth, and motion. So motion, as you can see, I guess, is the glowing effect there, as well as, material. There's different kinds of material, I guess. Like you can see, if I go back to the home screen, you can see the acrylic down here is on the recent applications, the background behind, on top of the BMW there. Like the background underneath the selection here. So going back to the guide, so if I click friends, I can view my friends list there. And I can join a club and do all kinds of things. So the main tab or the Xbox tab, so I can go home from here, I can go my games and apps, the store, and as well as pins, recent apps here, recent apps and games, as well as Xbox Live Gold stuff. Communication, so this is where your messages would be. You can start a new message and messages from Xbox Live, so any messages that Microsoft might send to you, so there we go. Or other conversations here, so there we go. Broadcast and capture, this is where you can start broadcasting to Mixer, Microsoft's competitor to Twitch. There we are, so I can broadcast, I can, or I can capture. So I can, you know, start capturing as well, and we'll get into some of the game DVR stuff later. And then system, so two system notifications, as well as, you know, setting, you can get to your settings, Xbox Assist, which I guess is a new thing, and you can turn off and restart the console from here as well. So, yeah, there we go. So the home screen looks very similar. So you have your most recent game or application here that's, you know, large, as well as, you know, the last four programs as well. So you have the five most recent programs. You can view content from Xbox Live Gold. If I go down, you can see your pins. So these are all my pins that I have. And then I can press Y to edit these, and I can move them around. And then if you go down one more, you have the welcome. So you can see what's new with Xbox and how to do certain things. So there we are. If I go down again, I can do more things. I can get ready for Xbox One X. I guess this is just advertising for different things. So you know, I can see game snaps I might like, Xbox Game Pass, which is Microsoft's subscription service for games, Xbox Live Gold, as well as Xbox One X related things. So there we go. I think that's all the menus. Yes, it is. That's all. It's on the home tab, mixer tab. I don't really go into the mixer tab much. I don't use it. But yeah, all your mixer related shit here. The community tab looks to be a bit different here, so I guess I can, you know, this is where you click to share something. It looks, I guess, more like a different feed. Before, it was just a vertical list of what your friends have been doing, whether they've added a new friend, made a game clip, took a screenshot, unlocked achievements, or whatever. But I guess now it's more of a different feed-looking thing. It looks a bit prettier, so, you know, if I wanted to, let's see, I've got someone that's, let's see, so someone's unlocked an achievement there, someone was broadcasting, there we go, yeah, so this is all the stuff, you know, it just looks a bit prettier, so here we are, here's a game clip, so if I just, you know, watch this, that's a game clip, so you have your, controls there, so let's go back, oh, if you're in, I guess, okay, so I guess if you're in here, you can hit the left and right to view different things. You know, go across. So if I just go back. Yeah, and there we are. So that's the community tab here as well. So and you can view club stuff here. I'm not part of any clubs, so yeah. Entertainment is the Microsoft Movies and TV stuff, as well as what used to be Groove, although Groove doesn't exist anymore. There's Netflix as well, too. So, this, of course, will be dependent on your region. Some regions have more services and stuff, so, yeah, because I'm in Australia, I get the shitty Australian Netflix, and I don't want to have anything to do with that, because it's rubbish, so. And then there's the Xbox Store, so the store, this tab looks basically the same, except updated with Fluent Design elements, so. Yeah, there we go. I really like the way this looks, to be honest. You know, with the glowing selections and the acrylic parts down below here. You know, I think it looks really nice. The user interface seems a lot more fluid, a lot smoother, and the transitions seem a lot more fluid. Might seem a little bit laggy on this recording here, since I'm using the Xbox app to do this, so, you know, it's going over my network, but overall it seems you know, pretty smooth, pretty nice to use. I actually really like it. I really like the way the guide's been redesigned here. I like the horizontal tabs better, so you don't have to, you know. Before, what you had to do, say if you were in a game and you wanted to go home, you had to click home, click the home tab, and then click home again. So it was like three clicks. Now it's only two, so you just press Xbox and then go home. So we're already at home, so it's not going to do anything, but yeah. So this home screen design is actually modular too. This is actually completely customizable, unlike previous Xbox home tabs, which have been, you know, it's just the same template for every, you know, every single user. This is supposed to be modular, so you can actually add and remove sections. So you can pin different things to the home screen. You can actually pin favorite friends and stuff as well. So actually, let me see if I can try that. I'm not sure how to do it. Let's see if I go friends, and if I go, let's see, can I go and pin him? Let's see. Oh, add to home. So if I add, you know, friend here, so now he is on my home screen. So there we are. So now I have access right to his stuff. So what he's doing right now, he's currently playing Grand Theft Auto 5. So yeah, there we go. And you can, I can see, I can go to his profile. I can send him a message or invite him to a party. He is 40 gamer score points ahead of me, apparently. So yeah, and as well as I can view a latest game clip from him. So which is nice. So and I can edit this as well. So here we are. So I can actually move this to any part of the home screen. So I can put it above. I can have my pins above him if I want, or I can have the welcome, you know, part as well. So you can add. You can add or remove any kinds of things. I can delete it as well. So if I just hit X, there we go. It's gone. So if I hit Y again, I can delete this welcome section if I want, which, you know, I'm not ever going to need. So there we are. I can move it around. I'm just going to leave it here for now. But yeah, I can't remove this one, of course, the advertising. Yeah, you got to have your advertising, don't you, Microsoft? Yeah, I saw a thing on Twitter earlier today. Well, actually yesterday, of Microsoft putting ads in the fucking Microsoft account page. So yeah, no, don't do that. but I digress. That's irrelevant to what we're doing here. But yeah, so I really like the concept of the you know, customizable things. You know, if I have a, you know, couple, you know, like say if I want like a group or something that I wanted to add. I think that, are they called groups? Yeah, groups. Yeah, if I want to have a group or something that I could, you know, add to my home screen just to quickly launch it, or a specific friend or something like that. Can I do the same with games? Let's see. So add to home. Yeah. So if I click Grand Theft Auto 5 here and go add to home here, so I now have a dedicated section right for Grand Theft Auto, and I guess for, yeah, there we are. Now it's filling up with different things, so I can see what's like a trending game clip, as well as latest, you know, news for, or latest posts by Rockstar, you know, for GTA here, as well as if I click Y, I can delete it and customize it. So I can also see who's also playing the game right now. So yeah, if I just, I can delete that. And there we are. So I really like this concept of the customizable home. It actually, you know, I'm not sure what I'm going to do with it. I just like just a basic launcher for games and apps. That's real. I really use it for. But yeah, it is nice to. Maybe I might pin a couple things. I don't know. I'll have to play around with it and have a look. Now there's also a system-wide light theme, like I mentioned earlier when we're still installing. So I guess to get to that, we have to go to system, go into the settings here. So. Let's see, the settings app's also a little bit reworked. I guess it's more of the same, just looks a little different. So if I go personalization, I think it's in my color and background. So my color, let's see. Is it in here? It's going to... so I can change my accent color from here. So I hope it hasn't... Yeah, so I like the sort of... the silverish gray there. Theme and motion, there we go. So if I go system wide, light theme now. I'm not a fan of light themes. I like everything, you know, dark. I prefer white on black. So I prefer white text on black with mostly, if that's an option, I'll choose that option 100% of the time. So this light theme's not for me, but as you can see, it actually, well, give it, let's see, if I gave myself a different accent color, it doesn't look as good with this gray. The silver color I have for my profile, but if I, let's see if I chose, what would look good with white? Hey, that blue wouldn't look too bad. There we are. If I chose that, did I change it? It did. Oh, actually, yeah. See, that looks good. I like that. See, the white and blue, that actually looks nice. So if I go home, will the home screen look different? Yeah, it will. So now you can see the acrylic part down the bottom here is a much lighter color. And if I gave a different background, rather than that BMW there, if I gave a different background, it'd probably look a bit nicer. So there we are. So yeah, system-wide light theme. So now if I go to this tab here, you can see everything's a lighter shade now. Instead of having dark gray and black shades for everything, now it's white and light gray, which is... You know, it's a bit more consistent and gives users more options. So, you know, now it sort of matches more with a lot of the other settings in Windows 10. So, I personally prefer dark themes because I am a loser who sits at home in a dark room all day playing video games. So, I am going to go back to the dark theme, and I didn't want to go to my profile. Whoops. That was by accident. We go back to settings here. If I go... Oh, my color and background. I'm just... and change it back to that. There we go. But that is the system-wide light theme. It actually it doesn't look too bad, but it's not for me. But yeah. So I'm guessing a lot of the default apps are different as well. So this is my profile, and this looks significantly different from the way it used to look. So you can see I can customize my thing here. I can you can see I'm currently at home on the home screen. You can see my gamer score. But you can also see my recent activity now down here. I don't think this was a thing before. This is its own separate tab. So you can see I unlocked an achievement about a week ago, as well as, you know, game clips and whatever else, and my bio and my location. But if I go to social here, this is a different tab. So this, you can see this is a complete list of achievements and other activity that I've done over the last however long. There we go. If I, because that's my activity feed. I guess if I go following, this is, oh, okay, this is so I, you can see the people who are in my friends list, friends, games, clubs, followers, you know, blocked people and muted people. So, you know, if I go followers, these are the people who have added me on Xbox Live and, you know, the ones I haven't added back because I'm a jerk. But yeah, so these are the other, you know, people who are following me on Xbox Live. So if I go gaming, you can see this is, I guess, where the leaderboard stuff is. Yeah, there we are. So gamer score leaderboard, I can see who's leading. Not me, obviously. But yeah, yeah, so you can see who's leading in gamer score stuff. So there we go. Where am I on this list? 85. I've only done 85 this month compared to 735 by, you know, someone else. But, and I can view the one for September 2017. And where am I on this list for September? Oh, there I am, 250. Okay. So, and we can see the top three. So, yeah, if I go October. And if I go watch here, so you can see this is where all my game clips are, as well as screenshots and stuff. So this is everything that I've done. You can view my game clips and screenshots here as well. So, yeah, this is not just to brag about me, but I guess this is just a redone profile page. So it's a bit simpler and cleaner. This tab, this social tab, is a little weird. I guess I've sort of combined the activity feed as well as the following and friends tab, which used to be two separate things, but it's the same. So it's kind of interesting, I guess. It doesn't look too bad. I really like the way this is designed. So the game DVR has also been has seen a bit of a major overhaul in this update as well, and this is a pretty big thing. The biggest change of these is finally an upgrade from 720p to 1080p on across all Xbox consoles, as well as if you have an Xbox One X, when that comes out, you'll also be able to do 4K recordings. So that is pretty nice. I do like that they finally upgraded the quality, so now, you know, I'll be able to do 1080p on this console if I get a 1X, you know, 4K. And that's at 60 frames a second, too, which is very nice, although, finding a game that actually runs at 60 FPS on the Xbox One is, PC Master Race. You're also able to record not just to the internal hard drive anymore. Now you're also able to connect an external hard drive, which I think is actually, you know, a big deal, because a lot of people buy 500 gig Xboxes, and that fills up really quick. Like, even if you only have like a few games installed, like a 500 gig Xbox, you know, is, yeah, basically nothing. So, you know, if you want to just hook up, say, a 2 terabyte or 3 terabyte hard drive, and you want to, you know, do game recordings to that, now you can. Having this game DVR stuff built in is pretty nice, so you don't have to rely on a capture card or some other method of, you know, recording your game clips. It'd be great if it was system-wide, so I wouldn't have to run my Xbox over the network here and record using my PC, but, you know, I don't think I can. All I can do is manage captures from here. I can't record now because I don't have a game running, but... Yeah, so if I could just go manage cap... Oh, that's... Yeah, so it's going to bring me to this same screen. This hasn't changed. You could also be able to hook up that same external hard drive to to your computer and transfer the game clips right there for, you know, editing or whatever else you want to do with them. So, yeah, that's actually a pretty good idea. I like that a lot. So one big thing that's basically been added for the Xbox One X launch is the ability to do bulk data transfers over your network to your new console. So basically, what Because what you're able to do now is the ability to download 4K assets and stuff for your Xbox One X if you want to. Say if you have one of the newer games that's been enhanced for the One X, like, say, Forza Motorsport 7, which is, not in this list of games I'm showing at the moment. But I guess so if I go, here, I can, I think it's under Manage Game. I'm not sure. Where would it be? I don't know where it would be, but I guess you can do transfers of games to your Xbox One X, and you're also able to save system data and configuration settings to an external hard drive. So you can just plug that straight into your new Xbox One X and transfer your data over straight that way. So they're making the process of going from an old Xbox to a new one very nice and very simple and very clean and whatnot. So I really like that. Another feature that's also been added is support for USB webcams, which I'm not going to be demonstrating for you today because I don't have another webcam lying around. At least that's not accessible. But anyways, one thing you're able to do now is the Kinect, I guess, is officially dead because of this, because this feature finally lets you able to be able to plug in any webcam that you can use with Skype, or if you're streaming to Mixer, you can also do that as well. Using any old webcam, you can have your face cam in your live stream, or if you want to use Skype, you don't have to have a Kinect, which is great. Kinect, I guess, is officially dead now, because the apps that rely on video sources, on video cameras can now, not have to need one. So, that's good. You don't need to have a Kinect. I mean, I guess the people who bought a Kinect are pretty salty about that, but, Microsoft have been trying to kill that thing off ever since the Xbox One S came out. So, because the One S and the One X do not have a Kinect port in the back of them. So, I don't even think they give you that adapter for free anymore. So, I guess if you're a Kinect owner, it sucks to be you. But for everyone else who, lives in a real world, you can just hook up a USB webcam and use it with Skype and use it with, live streaming. That's all good. Here is the Xbox One network transfer option. So here we are. It's just under Settings, Network, and Network Transfer. So if I go Allow Network Transfer, this will allow my Xbox consoles, any more, if I only have one in the house, but to copy games and apps from each other over the network. So if you buy an Xbox One X and you just want to get all your game data on there, especially if you've downloaded all the 4K assets beforehand, you can do that. I'm just going to disable that again because, this is the only Xbox I have here, so I don't want to do any of that clogging up my network. So a new feature that's been added with this update as well has been additional idle options. So additional screensaver options. This doesn't seem like it would be much of a problem, because back in the days of CRTs and plasmas, burn-in options, if you left your console on for a long time, would, be a big problem. Having brighter elements on the screen would burn in, to the screen, and, that would be bad. Hasn't really been a thing for the last while with LCD TVs. However, now with new OLED screens, that could be a bit of a problem again. So Microsoft are adding some features help mitigate that. You can enable this option in your settings. So when your console goes idle, so say after what I've got mine set to is 10 minutes, it will show different things on the screen. Instead of just dimming the screen, it says when the console goes idle after a few minutes, Xbox continues to show missed activities and notifications. So, it'll just, I'm not going to be able to demonstrate this for you here because I really don't feel like waiting 10 minutes for it to, do that. But there we go. So, after a while, it will, start showing. It will basically have, it's a better screensaver than just dimming the screen, especially if you have an OLED TV or an older plasma or something, if you're still using one of those. But yeah, so that's nice that they're adding that. So now we're going to be moving on to some of the more minor features that have been added with this update, which there is a fair few of them. So first one is, now you can actually sort the games between what, type of games they are. So if you just click on this third option here in the My Games and Apps section, you can see Xbox One Enhanced Games Only. So there's one of them, Gears of War 4, Xbox One Games, as well as Xbox 360 and original Xbox games, which that's one thing that I did mention that has been added with this update, is support for original Xbox backwards compatibility, which is Yeah, that's fucking dank, man. Unfortunately, right now there's not any games that I care about, so, you know, and I don't have any physical copies, and I really don't want to buy any from the store, so, of the ones that are compatible, but later on, you know, they will be adding more and more games to the list, just like they did back in 2015 with the Xbox 360 compatibility. So, if I had any 360 games installed on here, I could see them here as well. So, yeah, so I can see only 360 and original Xbox games, Xbox One games only, or Xbox One X enhanced games. So there we are, you can filter the list depending on, you know, what you want. So I'm just going to show all of them at the moment. But yeah, there we go. So as you can see, here's the screensaver running that we were talking about earlier. So yeah, I guess if I had missed notifications and stuff like that, I'd be able to see them. But right now all you can see is the time down there. So another feature, and this is not just unique to Xbox One, but pretty much every Microsoft product, is the Xbox Store, or the Windows Store, is now being renamed to Microsoft Store. So, and that's, you know, going forward. So as you can see, if I open the guide here, you can see the store icon below the home icon, below the home selection there is different. So you can see it's now just a flat icon with the Microsoft logo instead of the Xbox or Windows logos. So, yeah, there we are. So on the store tab, the store, you know, still works and functions the same. So if I just, you know, go, say, browse games, it still has the old logo for whatever reason. But, yeah, I guess the store still works the same. And the store actually doesn't have Fluent Design in it. So yeah, you can see the difference between Fluent Design and the old design language. So if I just go home, yeah, the store, I guess hasn't, I guess it, is there an update for the store available? There might be. No, there isn't. Okay. Whatever. I guess that'll change over time, but yeah, now the, going forward, the branding for the store will now be Microsoft Store. So now is a new Xbox Assist app. So if we just go down here, this has replaced the old Xbox Help app. So if we just go in here, we'll be able to, you know, do different things. Of course, the app has Fluent Design and all that stuff. So, you know, you can go tips and, you know, do different things. How-to videos and stuff like that. So, you know, if you need anything, any help using your Xbox or whatever, because console peasants are stupid, you'll be able to, you know, go in here and have a look. So, yeah, there we go. The limit of pins has now been raised to 40, so now because there's a dedicated area for pins, I guess they've, you know, increased the number of pins to, you can now have up to 40 pins. I'm not sure what the previous limit was. It might have been 20, I think, I'm not sure. But yeah, so now you can pin a lot more stuff to your home screen, so now to the dedicated pins section on the home screen. Arabic and Hebrew support have been added, so, you know, unlike a lot of Americans tend to think that English is the only language and that America is the only country that seems to matter, but spoiler alert, you're wrong! So Arabic and Hebrew support have now been added, so you can use and run the dashboard with the in Arabic or Hebrew. So, you know, if you speak those languages, then there you go. And, well, if you speak those languages, you're probably not even listening to this because, well, this video is only in English, unless if you're bilingual, so. Mixer now supports 1080p streaming, so, yeah, that's, I guess that's good. I'm not really a fan of Mixer, to be honest. My live streaming is all done on YouTube, and if it's not, you know, basically YouTube and Twitch is where it's at for streaming for me, but, you know, I guess if you want to do Mixer, then you can, but, you know, so now you can do 1080p. So Microsoft's catching up to shit that was around 10 years ago. So, no, I'm kidding. But, yeah, Mixer now supports 1080p, which is nice. Another addition on the dashboard is previews of streams on the Mixer tab, which is what we're looking at now. So, as you can see, this is previewing someone's stream playing Destiny 2. So, there we go. This is just previewing right now. It's a featured stream, so I don't know if there's a way to refresh that, but yeah, so it's just previewing whoever the hell is streaming here. This guy that probably looks better than I do, so yeah, whatever. So notification sorting is a little bit different now. So you may have noticed that so multiplayer notifications for like being invited to a party or being invited to a game will now appear under the multiplayer tab of the guide. And so this frees up the action center as you can see, system notifications are appearing on the system tab. So if I click that, you can see I have two system notifications, and there we are, those are the two system notifications. So as well as I guess if you had message notifications that appear under the communication tab, people notifications would appear under here, I guess, and multiplayer stuff would appear under here as well. So yeah, I'm not sure how I feel about that. I sort of like the idea of just having all the notifications under one space, but I guess they're going to go this way. I'll see how I like it. I don't know if I will, but yeah, notifications are now sorted under different tabs. Active widgets are going to be on the guide. So for example, if you're in an Xbox party chat or if you're broadcasting a game, there will be a widget displayed on the guide, which will give you quick access to various options. So I'd have to join a party to do that. So yeah, I'm not sure how that would work. Let me see if I start a party here. There we are. See, now I'm in a party. So if I go into the guide, there is the party there. So now it appears as a widget. So there we are. And I can do whatever I want with the party there. So I'm just going to leave because I don't want to be in a party by myself, because a party of one is very, very sad. So friends can now be sorted by what game they're playing. So under the people tab, I should be able to, I think you're able to sort. So friends and games, I think that's this. So as you can see, you know, I have one friend here that's playing, you know, one game. So there we go. You can sort out friends by what game they are playing. So I guess if I had more, so anyone who's playing Grand Theft Auto 5 would appear in this section. And then say if someone else was playing Destiny 2 or whatever other game, or Forza or something, you know, they'd appear in a separate section. So that's, I guess that's kind of neat. If you're looking for specific people, if you, want to play games with specific people, you can just look in say, oh, these bunch of people are playing Grand Theft Auto, let me join them or whatever, you know. So game hubs now have welcome tabs. So if we just go to a game hub, let's see, we just use the one for Grand Theft Auto 5. There is now a welcome tab, which cultivates various content across the hub into one centralized location. So there we are. So I can see captures, the activity feed from Rockstar, any people, so like, people that have done game clips and stuff, broadcasts from the community. So I guess this is broadcast on Mixer. Achievements as well, and clubs and stuff. So oh yeah, this is all on the welcome tab in a game hub. So there we are. So that has been the an installation and tour of the Xbox One fall update for 2017. Overall, I think this update is great for Xbox One. It's the first introduction of the Fluent Design Language, at least as well as next to the Windows 10 Fall Creators update that's also coming out at the same time as this. That brings some much-needed design flair to Microsoft's design language, and I really like it. I really love Fluent Design. It looks great. As well as a lot of these new features, such as Xbox One X, the transfers for Xbox One X, original Xbox backwards compatibility, you name it. There's a fair few updates and a lot of new features in this update, and I think it's all great. Like, there's really, if there's only one thing I had to complain about, it would be the way they're doing notifications now, splitting it across different sections. I don't like that as much, but yeah, like say, multiplayer notifications would appear under this tab and friend notifications will appear under here, and it's kind of hard to demonstrate when you don't have any notifications, but overall I really like the this new update. So it's going to be, of course, it's compulsory, so if you have an Xbox One you're going to be getting it. If not, you already probably do have it, because I'm a bit late to the party with this. But there we go. So there is the Xbox One fall 2017 update. So yeah.
Thanks for watching my video, guys. I really hope you enjoyed it. If you liked it, hit the thumbs up button. If you didn't, well then hit the other button. Now check out another video that's being suggested to you right now, should be on the screen. And as always, thanks for watching. I'll see you guys in my next video.